We know that there are social distancing rules in place, but those farmers are bringing that fresh produce to market, and it's a really good time to go make some choices and then talk about some of the selections that you've picked or some of the things that are available there. There is the opportunity to get out and to see some of those markets in action, and they are able to be open, but again, social distancing and hand washing are in place, so it's good to have some talks about what that could entail with your child. But getting out and seeing some of those choices, what's available right now, what's seasonal, is a good way to learn.
It's natural for people to eat lighter during the warmer months of the year. One of the benefits of eating lighter is that we often eat healthier foods, especially those in-season, lower-cost fruits and vegetables. A K-State Research and Extension Nutrition Specialist also says that it's a good time for parents to help children learn more about nutrition and how to prepare the food they've bought or grown themselves. On today's Sound Living, Healthy Summer Eating. Sound Living is a weekly public affairs program produced by Research and Extension at Kansas State University. I'm Jeff Wichman. K-State Research and Extension Nutrition Specialist Sandy Procter says that food helps families form a connection. It can create lasting memories, and it can also be educational. Sandy, this is probably one of my favorite times of the year because it gives me an opportunity to eat a lot of the things I like, fruits and vegetables, and it also allows me to save a little bit of money at the grocery store because all of that is in season right now.
I think you are among the many of us who are waiting for the tomatoes to get ripe and looking forward to all the literal and not so literal fruits of summer. There's lots of enjoyment to be had in growing foods, cooking outdoors, and just being together, although we've had quite a dose of being together, but being together with family and being able to share hopefully some of those meals that are still sort of relaxed and focused on some of the positives that we can pick up from a really nice time of year. The weather and the fruits and vegetables are plentiful. The weather's been nice, and so it's a good time to take advantage of some of these positive things.
I guess another positive is the fact that these foods are good for us. They're healthy, nutritious food.
You know, it's true. In the winter, when it's cold, we sometimes have a tendency to lean toward what we think of as comfort foods. And a lot of times, those foods are just that. They are extremely appealing to us, but they may be higher in calorie. They may be a little more dense with some sauce, or, you know, I'm thinking like casseroles or heavier soups and stews. And so sometimes, even though some of the ingredients are healthy, we lean toward higher calorie foods in the winter. And part of that's just because we need more calories to keep us warm, at least in theory. And so we sort of tend in that direction. But in the summer, we have more opportunities and more of an inclination to eat lightly with lighter foods and vegetables, maybe individual foods as opposed to combination or casserole type foods. And so, yeah, the foods are delicious, and there's a real healthy benefit to most of them.
We're always trying to follow the My Plate model, so when we talk about that in terms of summer food, what would maybe be some ideas that you could throw out?
Well, it's really easy. When you look at My Plate and you see that at least half your plate should be fruits and vegetables, this is where it gets really easy. There are so many opportunities to put colorful fruits and vegetables on your plate and really make that the focus of the meal. And then the other groups, grains and protein and dairy, those certainly add to those maybe plant-based meals, but they aren't usually center stage a lot of times in the summertime. So for example, you can have all sorts of fruits and vegetables and maybe a bit of pasta and just a small amount of meat or fish or proteins of some sort and have a wonderful salad that has lots of colors and nutrients, is cool to prepare. You don't have to do a lot of heating up of the kitchen, and that's always a consideration for us, is if we get our homes cool, let's do what we can to have meals that keep it that way. And so there's lots of ways to really look at that My Plate and think, oh, this is maybe just a bit easier to accomplish in the summertime.
There are some things that we can substitute in terms of protein, too, and I think that works out pretty nice this time of year. I know there are a lot of people who like the cold bean-type salads.
And that's a really excellent thing to consider to add in. Whole grains and legumes and beans, in salads. They can be cooked ahead. They can be canned. And they provide fiber and a lot of really important nutrients, very low cost. And they're ready for your creativity. They're waiting on your shelf. We've been having them on hand as ready resources. Hopefully our pantries are stocked and ready to go. But yes, you can use all sorts of things that would normally go in maybe a chili or a casserole in the winter can make really great parts of salads and summer meals.
We've had the children around for a long time because of the COVID-19 situation, but this is something we run into a lot in the summertime is how do we make sure that they're still getting the nice, healthy meals, but maybe not overdoing those meals because we also want to think about portion control.
Well, it is important that there be real meals and snacks in between and not just an opportunity to graze all day long. Although with growing kids, it's really hard to know how to have some of those breaks in the feeding through the day. So probably a better bet for that is to just make sure what you have on hand and what you keep around are healthful choices. And then whatever kids choose to eat and when they choose to eat it, they have healthy choices to pick from. So that might be fruits and vegetables, that might be whole grain crackers or tortillas, nut butters, things that they can make sandwiches or other types of snacks, maybe peanut butter on celery or apples, and really have some really positive nutrition and get a variety of foods and really meet some of those calorie needs they have because it's such an active time here. And even though we're still staying at home and some of our activities are curtailed, we know that happy, healthy kids are out there running and moving and needing a lot of fuel.
We also wanted to talk about the fact that this is a good time to really talk about nutrition and do things with your children that shows them how they can prepare these foods in ways that are nutritionally sound.
You bring up a really good point. It's a good time to think about going and maybe getting out to the farmer's market. We know that there are social distancing rules in place, but those farmers are bringing that fresh produce to market, and it's a really good time to go make some choices and then talk about some of the selections that you've picked or some of the things that are available there. And even though we're wearing masks and we want people to be really careful when they're out in public, it's a good way to see, you know, people having pride in growing their own food and sharing that with the public. So there is the opportunity to get out and to see some of those markets in action, and they are able to be open, but again, social distancing and hand washing are in place. So it's good to have some talks about what that could entail with your child. But getting out and seeing some of those choices, what's available right now, what's seasonal, is a good way to learn. And another opportunity that's particularly been good this year is to have a garden. I know a lot of people are very interested in gardening because, first of all, they're at home. They've got the time to be there and maybe oversee it. We had a lovely spring for planting, and the rain seemed, in our area at least, just nicely spaced for starting a garden. And it just seems like a really good thing to do. If you're trying to limit your trips to the grocery store, growing some of that important produce in your garden is a good hobby as well as a good way to infuse more nutrition into your diet. It doesn't have to be a large garden plot. And I hope parents have thought about this, that kids especially enjoy having a pot or a planter with maybe just a tomato plant or some herbs, something that they can sort of oversee, take care of. Maybe they helped plant it, pick out the seeds or the plants, watch it come up. All of those lessons are great to instill the love and the excitement of gardening, and that can last a lifetime. But it's also really exciting to see a plant grow and be able to pick those cherry tomatoes or look in there under all those leaves and there's a cucumber. And so it's really exciting for kids. And I know from just stories I've heard, but generations of gardeners, that many of them started early. The habit of gardening, the excitement of gardening started early when they spent time with their grandmother or with their parents out first just doing some of the basic tasks that little kids can do with a watering can, or this is a weed, this is the plant, be sure you pull this and not that. really working out there side by side with some of those adults that can help instill the love of gardening. It's a good way to get a very healthful practice under your skin, but also a good way to really help kids appreciate the flavor and the nutrition of some of the produce that they'll be lucky enough to take part in.
And I think the research shows that when they're more involved, they're also more likely to eat those vegetables.
Absolutely. Whether they're going to the farmer's market or in maybe better times, the grocery store, or growing some of that food themselves or involved in some of the gardening steps. Research does say repeatedly that there's some ownership there, and the child is likely to try more foods, be a little bit more adventurous, and to have a little bit more sense of repeat attempts to eat new foods that would maybe take a lot more convincing if they hadn't been involved.
Also an opportunity to maybe learn some ways to fix foods in different ways, maybe how to make mom's favorite pie or something like that, because those are things that you can pass down from generation to generation. You probably know how to make one of your mom's favorite pies.
Yes, and you learn that kind of thing. You have that discussion real early on. Sure, there's always a chance to talk about that later. It's like, wow, you know, I need to get this recipe from you. But a lot of that is learned right when you're just sort of almost underfoot. And so you get a job rolling out pie dough or cutting up apples. My husband tells a story of cutting up apples and eating almost many of them as he cut up, helping his grandmother when the apples were ripe in her yard. And I remember with my grandmother pitting cherries, and it never failed. The one pit you missed always was in my father's piece of pie. It never failed. And so some of those memories really start early, and they really do help create a love of cooking and of gardening. And getting back to one of the discussion points we share often, Jeff, the love and caring and family time that goes around food.
Well, and that is important because it does build those connections. But this is kind of interesting. What we're talking about today is the fact that you can do all of this and you can still eat good, healthy, nutritious food.
Oh, absolutely. And in fact, taking some of these steps and growing some of your own, we are more likely to eat more nutritious foods. And some of the other things we can do with kids to help them as they learn about nutrition is, you know, they're learning about all sorts of things in school. It's not too early to talk about reading labels, figuring out what's in foods by looking at labels. That's kind of a fun task for kids. And again, it's back when maybe they're in the stores, but when they're sitting there helping you cook, you can say, you know, here's why I chose this. Look at what the label said. What's the first ingredient? And, you know, to talk to them about what that means and how that can inform their healthy choices. It's certainly not time maybe for a full lecture, but some of those little life lessons just sort of sneak in around the edges. And young minds are very fertile. Those lessons have a very good chance of just sticking with them throughout their lives.
Extension has a number of publications related to healthy eating. They also have links to My Plate and all of that, so they can find all of that information online.
Oh, I absolutely would encourage anyone who's interested in healthy recipes or recipes that can be prepared on a budget, recipes using fruits and vegetables. There's actually an app that can be downloaded, Seasonal and Simple, that is a project that was done in Missouri in partnership with other states, Nebraska and Kansas included, where you can go on and see what fruits and vegetables are in season, and there are recipes that talk about how to use those. And so it can be a lot of fun to go and find that zucchini is very plentiful right now. What can we do with zucchini? And sure, you can make zucchini chocolate cake, but there's some delicious casseroles and mixed vegetable dishes and grain and vegetable combinations that can be created. And so really nutritious opportunities with new ingredients, and really a very educational time, but a delicious time too. Many of us are a little bit tired of some of the things that we have been fixing now for several weeks, and it might be time to infuse some new recipes using seasonal produce into our diets.
That's K-State Research and Extension Nutrition Specialist Sandy Procter. For Extension publications on health and nutrition, visit bookstore.ksre.ksu.edu or go to ksre.ksu.edu. Sound Living is a weekly public affairs program produced by Research and Extension at Kansas State University. I'm Jeff Wichman, and this is the K-State Radio Network.